I should say a word at the outset about how I first connected with Justice Jackson. As a member of the Legal Forum, while a student at the University of Virginia Law School, I invited the justice to Charlottesville to give a talk to the students. He accepted, drove down, was exhausted when he arrived, and looked forward with some trepidation to a full afternoon of activities before a reception and his talk that evening. I would have none of it. I took him to his hotel immediately upon his arrival, told him I'd wake him for the reception, and left him to sleep. When he woke later, he was fully refreshed, and we had a wonderful time for the rest of his stay. After I graduated, I wrote him asking if I could interview for a clerkship. He invited me to Washington. Since I had never clerked for a lower court judge, a custom then as well as now, I held out little hope that he would take me on. But after we chatted for a while about my law review work, his son Bill, world affairs, and so forth, he suddenly stopped me. He said, "Barrett, I will never have two law clerks again. If you will be my only clerk, the job is yours." Stunned, I did not lie and tell him that I needed a week to think it over. Instead, I accepted before the words were fairly out of his mouth. Parenthetically, he never explained to me why he would never have two law clerks again, and I never asked. But I think I can guess, and it is purely a guess, as to why there would not be two again. My theory is that he never got along too well with one of his two clerks preceding me, and not to bite the hand that founded us, but it was later to be Chief Justice William Rehnquist. And that relationship, in fact, was pretty rocky all term long. I base that guess on a number of factors, but two stand out. First, you recall that when Rehnquist's name came before the Senate, first for a justiceship and then later for a chief justiceship, a big point of discussion was a memo Rehnquist had written as a law clerk about Brown versus Board of Education. It was basically antagonistic to the result ultimately reached by the court. Rehnquist defended the memo by telling the Senate that Jackson had asked him to write down the justice's views of the case rather than Rehnquist's own views. This proved to be inaccurate later when Jackson's views of Brown were set forth in a never circulated or released opinion, which I will discuss shortly. The second reason is contained in a letter that Rehnquist wrote to Justice Frankfurter about Jackson in 1955, explaining Jackson to Frankfurter's request. Among other things, Rehnquist said in this letter that Jackson would not have a lasting influence on the court, that he had a tendency to go off half-cocked, that the justice's opinions didn't seem to go anywhere, and that he himself never felt that he had become a friend of Jackson's. These were hardly comments reflecting a close relationship between the two men. Incidentally, I wrote to Frankfurter again. duties.